Hello, everyone, and welcome back to another episode. I'm your host, the Millennial Investor, and in today's episode, we are going to be going over the top five ways to stay invested in this very, very volatile market. The market has been moving rapidly in all different types of sorts of directions, and some of my stocks in my portfolio, some of them have been skyrocketing in price, and then others, like, for example, my top holding Broadcom, for example, is starting to have a bit of a downtrend. And so how in this market am I able to maintain investing in my portfolio when things are very erratic, constantly moving around? One day, everything's up massively. The next day, everything's crashing. So how do I stay invested? How do I stay mentally stable during these times of very volatile markets? Because when you look at the SPY, the S&P 500 ETF, you just see erratic spikes up over the last 5 years. During the peak of 2018, a massive quick downturn. During the end of 2018, at the end towards Christmas time and New Year's, a massive downturn. And then the beginning of 2020, a massive roaring bull market up, and then a massive downturn. And now we are once again in another roaring bull market. Massive upward moves and days sometimes being 2 or 3% moves on the indexes. And just the other day, I believe we saw the NASDAQ have like a 3 or 4% downward move. You can see these jagged spikes. Look at here. Just in the last month, you can see spike up, spike down, spike up, spike down, spike up, and another spike up the last day or two. And so how I stay invested throughout these times? Well, I'm going to go over my top five reasons. It's going to be a short, quick video. But if you're not familiar with me, my name is Jordan. I'm the Millennial Investor. The companies that I own are listed in column A right here, and this will be changing because I did just change some stuff in my portfolio if you've watched some of my videos in the past. And this is my annual and monthly dividend income that I track through these charts, and I update them every single month right here. They also have my portfolio value and my monthly YouTube income, once again, updated every single month. I have my five investing goals for 2021 posted right here. Annual dividend income of $600, portfolio value of $20,000, YouTube income of $3,000, 150 for referrals to M1 Finance, and 20 out of my 24 companies that I currently owned at the start of 2021 to raise their dividend at least once. And then my 2021 stock market prediction at the end of the year is so far relatively close to that number. We'll see how it ends out. But if you look at number four right here, 150 referrals to M1 Finance. So far, we've done very good on that goal. And as you see me talk throughout this video, you see this brokerage called M1 Finance. That is what I'm showcasing right now. This link is down below in the description. If you download this link that I'm hovering my mouse over right now, it is down below. If you download it and deposit $100 to the platform, you'll get $10 just for signing up. We've had 102 people sign up so far. Every one of them has said that they love it. It's a great platform with some awesome features with no fees whatsoever. So if you want to sign up for that, you can get $10 for doing so. Or if you want to invest and look at my pie personally, that is also shared down below, as well as lots of other things, including mentoring calls, got a savings account, credit card referrals, and lots of other things like that. But let's go ahead and get into my number one way to stay invested. And this one is very basic, very simple, and is pretty much just stay the course. Now, it doesn't matter what investing strategy you do, but typically speaking, if you have a set dollar amount to invest in the market, it doesn't matter what your strategy, okay? So let's say that you're talking about, you're an index investor, okay? You just invest in the S&P 500 or the NASDAQ or the Dow Jones, and no matter what, you're going to put a set dollar amount. Generally speaking, in the long run, on a 2, 3, 4, 5, 10-year period, you are going to have charts that look like this. Look at this. This is the NASDAQ, okay? Let's look at the S&P 500 on a 5-year chart. This is the S&P 500, straight up and to the right. Let's go ahead and look at the Dow Jones. Is it DIA, I believe? Yeah, DIA, the Dow Jones ETF. Once again, 5-year chart, straight up and to the right, not to mention dividend payments along the way. If you're investing in indexes, generally speaking, you invest a set dollar amount every week or every month or every quarter, and you invest for the long term. Don't worry about what the market's doing. You're going to dollar cost average into the market. And the same thing goes for a dividend investor like myself. I'm a dividend growth investor, and I look for companies that can consistently produce cash flows and hopefully over time raise the net income of the company over time so they can increase their dividend payments, become more valuable as a company. So let's look at a company like, for example, my number one holding, Broadcom, okay? This is the one that is my number one holding. I have almost 10% of my portfolio just in this one company. And once again, on a 5-year chart, it's up and to the right. And the dividend payments, not only is the share price, but the dividend payments go up and up and up over time, okay? Now, recently, if we go to this 1-month chart here, It's been downtrending. It's went from what was earlier about $490 a share or so, was just yesterday $420. So $70 a share downturn. And for me, this being my largest investment, when this goes down, it hurts me. I feel the pain. And the same thing on the upside. If this were to double in share price next year, it would definitely make my portfolio perform very, very well. But when we talk about staying the course, it doesn't matter if you're a dividend growth investor, an index investor, a growth investor, it doesn't matter what the case may be. Long story short is that if you're buying great companies and you're consistently investing, if you're not constantly being in and out of the market or just barely messing around with it, I think that generally speaking, if you stay the course, number one is most important. If you stay the course, you'll be just fine. Number two, do not watch stock prices consistently. When I look at these companies, let's go ahead and pick one that I've had since day one. Let's look at, say, for example, how about Home Depot? Home Depot is a company that I've had since day one. And if you look at this five-year chart, or actually, let's just look at the last 2 years, because I've only invested in Home Depot for about the last, 11 months or so. And this company has went up. It's hit peaks. Since then, it's even traded downwards. And all during that time, I've been investing in Home Depot steadily. I didn't stop once the company went down in price, and I didn't increase it once the company went up in price, or flip side, not opposites of that either. I just steadily invested into these companies. And one of the ways that I'm able to do that is that I'm not obsessively watching the stock prices of these companies. I don't go to my one-day performance here and look whether or not my portfolio is up and down every single day. And I don't constantly check, oh my gosh, which companies are performing the best, like Caterpillar's up the most today, and my worst performers were Red Stocks. Once again, Broadcom is my worst stock of the day. I'm not constantly watching these prices. I just focus on the general movement of these companies. Because some companies, like for example, a Caterpillar has went straight up over the last year. That's the general movement of the stock. But I don't focus day to day. There's a lot of times in my portfolio, I'll go a full day or sometimes even a full 2 days without even checking the prices of my general companies. So when you're focusing on the stock market, focus on the long term. Do not watch stock prices constantly, and it will keep you from being less volatile with your emotions alongside with the market. And then number three, you have to ask yourself, what is your why for investing? Okay. And the reason why I bring this up is that it is very important to ask yourself, what is the reason that you're doing this? A lot of people's general sense in the market is to make money. Like us all, I'm here to make money. So are you watching this video? I'm sure there's about a 99% chance that you're here to make money. But let's go deeper than that. What is the reason that you want to make money? Is it because you want stuff? Maybe. Is it because you want to take care of your family? Maybe. Is it because you want to change your family tree? You want to leave an inheritance to your family? Maybe you want to donate it to charity? Maybe you want to build a big house one day? That's your reason for investing. Then reason doesn't matter. It's unique to you. So your reason for investing, regardless of whether I agree with it or not, whether it's just to be greedy and to make money, whether you have a purpose behind it, what is your why for investing? And usually what I've noticed is that people's why, when they have a good why for investing, they typically have a better investing mindset. Now for me, for example, my why is I have a few goals. One of those is that I want to be able to retire early. I want my future wife one day to have the option to not be employed or to work part-time or to pursue schooling or really just whatever she wants. I want me one day to be able to have the choice, if I don't like my job or if I don't like the location that we're living at, to just be able to pick up and say, I don't have to do this anymore. And another thing, other things as well, like my future children, I want them to not have to worry about college expenses. I want my children to be able to know how to manage money because they had a father that showed them how to do it properly. All these things are the type of thing that I ask myself, what is my reason for my investing? What is my why with investing? And for me, that is a great reason. And one of the reasons why I bring this up is that if you don't have a good why, or if you don't even have one set in place in the first place, then you're much less likely to stay invested. So have a good why, have a good reason for investing, and you're much more likely to not be affected by these volatile markets. Number four, what was your original thought process when you first started investing into that company? Has that changed? Now let's go ahead and talk about Coca-Cola. This is one that I've been giving an example of lately because this is one that I'm long-term bullish on. Now short-term, 2021, maybe even 2022, I don't really know what's going to happen. This company has a lot of troubles facing it. They have some revenue issues. The good news is they're focusing on profitability. But what was my original reason for buying Coca-Cola? My original reason was they have a compelling management team. They have a great brand recognition behind their company. They have extreme profitability, and they have a company that just has just an awesome track record. Just overall great measures of success through not only dividend payments, but share price appreciation and overall just performance in the stock market going decades on back. Now, if we look at this company, it is downtrended over the past year or two. And basically, I haven't made hardly any money on this company. but the story has not changed. I want to own this company. I not only want to make money off it, but I want to have ownership in this business, because Coca-Cola is a company that I believe will be around for the long run. So my investing thesis, my bullish thesis around owning this company, my reason for owning it, has not changed. Now, if you own a company, like for example, I'll give you one for example, like one that I sold, okay? Wells Fargo was one that I owned in early 2020. This was the only stock actually in 2020 that I sold for a loss. Now, the good news is for Wells Fargo, they're starting to come back. But my reason for owning this company was that it was an undervalued bank. Not a very strong thesis there, and it had a good high yield. That was my other reason. Well, one of those reasons, the high yield, the dividend ended up getting cut. As you can see from this track record, it paid 51 cents a quarter, and then it got slashed all the way to 10. So what is that? That's like an 80% downturn. Massive downturn there. And the other reason was, it's an undervalued bank. I started asking myself, is this company really undervalued? And between the management decisions and the way that the company is running its bank, I wasn't sure if I could even answer that question anymore. So I decided to sell out of the company. That's my reason that I'm talking about. When the same thing like Coca-Cola, when it has a downturn, I'm still just as bullish as day one. So with number four, if your reasoning has not changed behind these companies, whether or not they're going up or down in share price, if your opinion on the company does not change, then I likely wouldn't recommend you to change your opinion on investing in that company, because you still have a bullish or bearish view on that company. And last but not least, we have number five. Be prepared for all market conditions. Have hedges, cash on the side, derivatives. Okay, and I'll go ahead and give you some example of this. So have hedges. One of the things that you could do, and I wouldn't really recommend this at a time like now because they're not very attractive, but something like, for example, owning a long-term treasury bond ETF. It's not super attractive right now with where interest rates are at. It's not horrible. I'm not totally against it, but that can have a hedge. Bonds are less volatile in a dropping bear market if we were to have one, which, let's be honest, anytime soon it could happen. I mean, literally any day now it could start. And if you had a bond portfolio, or if you had a bond position at least, it would be much less volatile than your equities. And the second thing is to have cash on the side. And this one that I'm highlighting, cash on the side, number two, is so important. Myself, I follow this rule, and I think everyone should have this. Now, what does that mean, cash on the side? That could mean many things. The first one, which I think everyone should have, everyone should have an emergency fund and some savings on the side. So that way, if they were to lose their job, if they were to have their hours cut, if they were to have to leave, if they were to have some type of horrible medical injury that had thousands of dollars in medical bills, if their car broke down, if their dryer broke down in their house, whatever the case may be, there's always going to be emergencies, and you're always going to need funds to have to replace those funds. So if you have an emergency fund, if you have some savings on the side, you won't have to draw from your investments. Like me, if I had $50 in my checking account and all of my money was tied up in this portfolio, if I slammed into a pole tomorrow and I needed to replace a car and spend thousands of dollars, there's almost no way I can afford that without either A, going into debt, or B, taking from these investments. And especially if this portfolio is in a downturn, then it's even worse time to take this from these investments. So always have cash on the side. One of the things that you can do with M1 Finance, I'm pressing this tab right here, Auto Invest. You see here where it says minimum cash balance? I have mine on zero. The actual minimum for M1 that'll let you invest is 25. So once this cash balance hits 25, whether that's me depositing, whether that's a dividend coming through, that's a referral from you guys, the moment that this hits 25 or more, it automatically buys these companies in my portfolio. Now the thing is, if I wanted to build a cash position while also investing, I could hit minimum cash balance. So let's say I wanted to have $1,000 cash while also investing. I could type 1,000. Oh, that's 10,000. I could type 1,000, and the moment I press that update button, that means that the companies will not be getting any investments until I have $1,000 cash. Now, let's say I had 1,100 cash. I would have $100 invested in the portfolio, and it would keep that 1,000 cash. And you could save that 1,000 or whatever your number is for a rainy day or for when the market downturns, whatever you want to do. But that's one of the things I can recommend using M1 for, and having cash on the side is always a great option. Now, last but not least, we have the third option. This is one that I don't recommend. This is one that I don't really stand by, and it's not one that I practice myself, but it is an option. If you're that worried, if you're that scared about the markets, take a small part of your cash and invest in derivatives. So you can invest in options and other platforms. One of the reasons that I do like M1 Finance is that they don't offer options. I kind of find that as a benefit, so you're not tempted, because in a lot of ways, especially as an option buyer instead of an option seller, it is very, very risky. It's very, very dangerous, and it's one that you should stay away from. But just to give you an example, once again, do not recommend this. Do not stand behind this. This is just, it's an option. This is something like, for example, a triple leverage bear ETF for the S&P 500. Now you can see during times of a downturn, this thing skyrockets. Let's look at the 2-year chart for this ETF. Now, before the market downturned in February of 2020, this was $115 a share. And then it skyrocketed over double in price to almost $300. So when the market downturns, this thing is basically shorting the S&P 500 with 3x leverage. So if the market goes down 1%, this ETF goes up 3%. If the market goes down 10%, this thing goes up 30%. So you can see how it is very easy for this thing to double or even triple in price if things were to downturn massively. But that said, if the S&P 500 is not in a massive downturn, then pretty much you're doing nothing but losing money, because generally speaking, stocks go up over time. But that's the top 5 ways that you can avoid selling in a downturn. That's one of the 5 ways you can stay invested in throughout all of these volatile markets. But if you own great dividend companies like I do, you're more than likely to stay invested through the form of these cash flows, because you're not so focused on price and you're constantly receiving cash payments for your investments. But thank you guys for watching all the way to the end. Like I said, go ahead and get signed up if you haven't already. But thank you guys so much for watching, and I'll catch you guys next time.